Dear Excellency Mindi Kodeli, Minister of Defense of the Republic of Albania, dear Ambassador Kuko, dear Captain Dimolari, distinguished members of the Consular Corps, ladies and gentlemen, and dear guests, welcome to the Führungsakademie, welcome to the 11th Hamburg Discourse. Albania, for most Germans, this beautiful country is still a terra incognita. Many Germans have traveled or worked in the Balkans, including thousands of German soldiers who have served in Bosnia, Kosovo, and Macedonia in the past 20 years. But for many of us, Albania remains a destination of the beaten track. Hopefully, this will change soon. I had the privilege to serve in Albania in the late 1990s. It was a troubled time, the peak of the Kosovo War. While NATO was still bombing former Yugoslavia to stop attacks on the Kosovo Albanians, I got the task as a colonel to prepare the deployment of German KFOR troops to Kosovo. During this time, I traveled a lot in the region, including our allied country, Albania. We created a major logistic hub in the harbor of Durrës, and I remember well the dangerous mountain road from Tirana to Kukish. One of my most memorable impressions of these days were the huge refugee camps in the Kukush region. Since 1999, I have visited Albania again several times. Every time, I recognize the significant changes and progress this country has made. An icon of these developments certainly is a modern highway from Tirana to Prizren through the Albanian mountains, replacing the old and dangerous mountain road. In recent years, Albania has more and more become an anchor of stability in the Balkans, with a growing economy and an increasingly stable democracy. The current government, under the leadership of Prime Minister Edi Rama, is determined to guide Albania into the European Union. In the past years, several major steps were made to reach this goal. For example, in May 2006, Albania and the European Union signed a stabilization and association agreement. And since June 2014, Albania is an official candidate for accession to the European Union. Tonight, we have the great opportunity to listen to the presentation of an essential member of Prime Minister Edi Rama's cabinet, Her Excellency Mimi Kodeli, Minister of Defense of the Republic of Albania. Her remarks will focus on the current situation in the Balkans and Albania's European perspective. Your Excellency, before I hand over to you, please let me give the audience a little bit of background information about your biography. Mrs. Mimi Kodeli was born in Tirana. She is married to Mr. Leka Kodeli, who is also joining us tonight, welcome, and has a son. Mrs. Kodeli holds a PhD in economic science since 2007, has a master's degree in business administration, and earned a bachelor degree in finance. Mimi Kodeli began her political engagement in 2002 when she was appointed deputy mayor of Tirana municipality. In 2005, she held the office of the prefect of Tirana's region, and in 2009 was elected as a member of the Assembly of Albania, additionally holding the office of the vice chair of the Committee of Economy and Finance throughout the legislature. She is member of the Socialist Party chairmanship since 2007. She has been trained in various fields, including international and security markets, labor and investment markets, small and medium enterprises, banking examination, and management. She participated in a US State Department program entitled Women in Politics, and attended the program for national security policies at Marshall European Center for Security Studies. Mrs. Codeli is fluent in English and Italian and has a good knowledge of French and Spanish. Excellency, we are very much looking forward to your presentation. The floor is yours.
Good evening, everyone. Well, something that the general didn't underline was my experience as a professor at the university for many years. So for me, being among people who in front of me listen what I have to say, it's quite a common issue, but it's not tonight a common issue. Because I never said something in front of such important people, with all respect, white hair. I do have white hair. You cannot see it, but I assure I do have a lot. So it's just between, you know, same generation, same friends. I'm coming from a place. General said, terra incognita. And maybe later on, if you'll have some questions after my speech, I will try to explain why Europe still consider one of the oldest countries in Europe terra incognita, such as Albania. But let me begin with my speech. It is an impressive moment for me being here among such a prestigious institution like the Führung Academy of the Bundeswehr, am I right? My German is absolutely in addition. Thousands of smart, ambitious, intellectual, and motivated people have passed through this lecture hall. So, General Litzba, I will try to give my best to match the motivation that your prestigious institution gives to all alumni and beyond. In Albania, there is a solid presence of officers that have gone through this academy. Two of them are together with me today. When I was checking the agenda of the event, I realized that this lecture hall bears the name of Manfred Werner, an important name for the politics of the late 80s and early 90s. An important name also for us, living beyond the Iron Curtain. A man that held the office of the NATO Secretary General for six important years, that shaped the future of post-communist Europe. A man that started negotiating peace in Bosnia and Herzegovina, calling for the use of NATO forces in 1994. I come from the specific region, what is used to be called Balkans, the Podikeg of Europe. During the last 25 years, many European politicians have tried to rebrand the region I come from. A considerable part of it has become part of the European Union, but it still remains the less developed part of our old continent, now called the Western Balkans. I see amongst you, of course, some uniforms from armed forces of allied and partner countries. Most of you know quite well the problems of the region, where I'm coming from. But some of you don't. So I'm not here only to define or give to you my version of the history of the Western Balkans, but to talk about the present and the future of my future of my region, and maybe more. I'd like to draw your attention, especially on the current issue. How do the current conflicts in Ukraine and in the Middle East influence on the Western Balkans? What is the international community doing to respond to any potential attack that can be caused by what is called the Podikag in Europe? We are living in not so bright days. All of us. Economic crisis was followed by the escalation of the conflicts in Ukraine, the rise of Daesh, and the waves of the refugees coming all the way up from the Middle East, here in Germany or elsewhere around Europe. Who predicted or envisioned any of what's happening around us 3 years ago? History is not written in advance, unfortunately. But we can prevent an edge of disorder if we have the will to do so. We can keep the international order that has served us so well if we stand up for its rules and if we stand up for each other. So everything depends on us. NATO member countries are recently facing various threats coming from the east and from the south. But having in common the principles of collective defense, crisis management, and cooperative security, concerns across the west, the eastern, and the southeastern flanks of the alliance are more than obvious. We must not forget the region that can easily be affected by international turmoil due to their instability and vulnerability. Western Balkans is one of them. Relatively far from Russia and relatively far from the Middle East, but largely influenced by the money and the ideology of Moscow and fundamentalism. The best examples of the region are Slovenia, Croatia, NATO and EU members, both of them. Albania is only a NATO member country, while Montenegro is going to become the newest one, quite close. So the other countries are countries for EU, candidates, sorry, for EU and NATO accession, based on different schedules and agendas. Maybe some have problems with their internal democracy. Some have problems with their names. Some have problems which nothing to do with the values. But meanwhile, Kosovo, for example, it's making great progress. Even Kosovo is having its own problems. The way towards EU membership is more complex for Western Balkans, unfortunately, and so is for my country. Political uncertainties and economic restrictions are weakening the dream of integration, even for Albanians. And in terms of such conflicts, we all agree that other conflicts can be easily prevented by an integration process and through an integration process, which will help a lot, is the only process that can help a lot. With the rise of nationalism in Europe, Russia has had a clear and concrete project for the Balkans, clearly determined influence points based on religion, and some other interests. It looks impossible. Russia is so far from Western Balkans, but in a sense, so close. Dreams of Western civilization of the Balkans have never been accepted by Russia. Nowadays, banks, businesses, tourists, infrastructure, gas and fuel companies in the Western Balkans are targeted by the Russian money. Russia's economic pressure is growing steadily in these times of difficulties, not only economic ones, for the West. We are not against good economic relations between countries, not at all. But there are some political forces in many countries of the region which see Russian way of thinking or doing as the best option for the future of their countries. Elsewhere, in the heart of the Balkans, they represent a significant part of that population. Moreover, the number of these people from the Balkans participating in the Russian hybrid warfare is obvious and disturbing the security not only of Western Balkans. Hundreds of millions of rubles invested in the region, joint military exercises with Russian troops near NATO country borders, pose a great concern and cause a huge controversy, in my point of view. On the other hand, the jihadist seeks fertile ground in Europe. The terrorist attacks in France and Belgium are an alarm bell for the risk and, of course, the modern civilization of today have to face it. There are our citizens who are participating in the ranks of Daesh as foreign fighters, mostly young people coming from all around the world, Europe, have been contaminated by the dangerous evil interpretation of a peaceful religion like Islam, becoming savage beasts with no mind, no heart, no soul, no values. We see and face their evilness every day, through their acts based on a violent ideology of hate and terror. And we need to give hope to our citizens by dealing in our best democratic practices with those young men who are killing people and are killing hope and are killing our future. What NATO and EU have done in the last 20-25 years, it is simply wonderful. Nevertheless, it is so drastic for the EU to accept several million people coming from the Western Balkans as its own citizens. No one is asking for gifts or privileges, but we think that we, with our values, will just do something very simple, very easy. Add these values to your values. Another issue. Waves of refugees are crossing through the Western Balkans, heading for Germany and northern part of Europe. They are bringing with them many of the problems they face, but they are also making us show most of the problems that we do have internally. As a politician, as a mother, as a sister, as a wife, as a feminist, as a socialist, I can't accept the way the refugees are being managed in my region and worldwide. And also I don't accept the political mix-up of refugees and immigrants that are moving towards the Western Europe. My personal interpretation of the 2014 Berlin Summit was that EU has not forgotten the Western Balkans, and this is very important. This was a powerful incentive meeting, but that may be not enough if the EU wants our countries to be prosperous member states one day. I do believe EU remains faithful to the European perspective promised to the Western Balkans. However, leaving all the responsibility to these countries results in losing the larger view of the disinterested EU, which has no desire to break the net that has left beyond the societies in this region. The same argument is valid for the regional integration into NATO. Of course, NATO's path is totally different and very clear to everyone who wants to be part of that family. But NATO must not forget that these dark forces coming from the East and the South want to stab the alliance on the back. The weakest point is close, somewhere between Albania, Croatia, Hungary, and Bulgaria. All these are NATO member countries which do have borders with non-NATO member countries. NATO has made important decisions to ensure and alert a strong alliance, including the intensification of the cooperation among partners by initiating the development of the defense capacities to help the alliance project stability and a clear present. A clear present. The open door policy was repeated, and now we are expecting the 29th member of the alliance. Montenegro is the new entry, the newly welcome member of, and we are really very excited to receive and to host Montenegro in our NATO common home. I hope this will happen with other countries in the region as well. And with those countries who share the same principle and democratic values, who don't want to be in NATO, he can use freely not to be in NATO. Once again, it is obvious that we're trying to narrow the spaces of the areas mentioned above, taking into consideration the significance of the security environment today. We have to move faster, but really faster. I firmly believe that the integration of these gray zones of Europe into the Euro-Atlantic community will make our alliance a better group of countries with common values for a collective protection. I'm pretty sure I share the same opinion with you. We all share the same European values and have the same objectives for the future. With more political will, the Eastern and the Southern conflicts will stay far away from Balkans, far away from Europe, far away from NATO borders and so on. All measures taken by NATO until now have a defensive nature, of course, and are proportional and in accordance with the international principles and commitments. And this is really good, and I really need to stress what I'm saying. This is the alliance response to potential risks and threats from East and South, and this is something good as well. Taking into account the current crisis and uncertainties, we must remember that peace and stability in our region, as elsewhere, cannot be taken for granted, even here in a safe country like Germany. History has taught us that as the world changed, NATO, EU, and the entire international community need to change. They must be able to quickly react, not only politically, but also to have the appropriate and necessary capacities to do so. The last thing, I grew up by listening to Paul Simon and Art Garfunkel, an American folk rock duo of the 60s. I'm sure that many of you here present remember this artist, as I'm sure General Litzpa does. And there is a particular song of these guys named Bridge Over Troubled Water. It's exactly what I have in mind when I talk about integrating the Western Balkans into the big Euro-Atlantic family. It's so easy to build up walls. It's...
Thank you.